Good day, dearest great surgeons. Today we're going to talk about hepatobiliary surgeries. This is a very important topic for all MRCS exams. If you are not a general surgeon, it might be confusing a little bit. So we're gonna crack this chapter in these voice shots. Together we can.
Did you know that ileal resection will cause a high risk for gallstone formation because bile salt reabsorption occurs at the ileum? Therefore, cholesterol gallstone will form as a result of ileal resection. In carcinoma of pancreas, there is a law called Courvoisier law. The Courvoisier law stated that the development of jaundice in association with a smooth right quadrant mass is typically of distal biliary obstruction, secondary to pancreatic malignancy. Jaundice with right hypochondrial mass is malignancy of the pancreas until proven otherwise. This is Courvoisier law. Take care. Patient with gallstone pancreatitis should undergo early cholecystectomy and enteral feeding help to minimize gut bacterial translocation and should be given to most patients with pancreatitis. And many studies have evaluated the role of octreotide in reducing the pancreatic secretion and shown no benefit. So octreotide, according to the study, has no benefit in reducing the pancreatic secretion. However, the use of antibiotic in pancreatitis is controversial. Cochrane review has presented a reasonable evidence in favor of administration of imipenem to prevent infection in established necrosis. So octreotide has no evidence in reducing pancreatic secretion. However, the imipenem as antibiotic can be used to prevent infection of the pancreas. From the very specific signs for acute pancreatitis is the Hamadian prayer, which is pain is being relieved on leaning forward. Yes, pain will be relieved on leaning forward of the patient. This is a diagnostic key in your practice. Take care. Although in acute pancreatitis, hyperamylizemia is being utilized broadly and widely by most of the surgeons to diagnose acute pancreatitis, but hyperamylizemia is not specific for pancreatitis, because it may be raised in acute pancreatitis and pancreatic pseudocyst and mesenteric infarction and perforated viscous or even acute cholecystitis can cause hyperamylizemia and diabetic ketoacidosis. Take care, it's not specific for acute pancreatitis. Why in the lipase is specific for acute pancreatitis? But it's more expensive, by the way. It's sensitive and specific serum than serum amylase for acute pancreatitis and has a longer half-life. But take care, lipase is more expensive. For scoring of the acute pancreatitis, you can use either Glasgow scoring or Ransom scoring or Apache scoring or even biochemical scoring using CRP. Bile duct injury is a very serious complication that no one wants to face, and the first best thing to do if you encounter this during the operation, put a drain and discuss with hepatobiliary surgeon. The bile duct injury has the worst outcome if the repair is performed by the same surgeon due many reasons, especially if inexperienced or he is not a hepatobiliary surgeon. Because of the stress and the difficulty of the operation. So, in the right hand, it will be very smooth operation. If, unfortunately, a bile duct injury, call a hepatobiliary and put a drain. Gallstone ileus can occur as a result of a fistula developing between the gallbladder and the duodenum. This tend to become impacted somewhat proximal to the ileocecal valve and cause small bowel obstruction. The correct management is to remove the gallstone from an enterotomy proximal to the site of the stone impaction not at the site of the impaction but proximal to the site of the impaction, and the bowel at the site of the impaction itself may not heal well, and an enterotomy performed at this site may result in need for resection. So why to resect when you can save the bowel? The standard surgical technique is that under almost all circumstances, the gallbladder should be left in situ. There is no cholecystectomy in the same situation while you are dealing with gallstone ileus. And the anatomy in this area is often hostile and unpredictable. Disconnecting it from the duodenum will leave a large defect that is difficult to close at that same time. But again, in gallstone ileus, please leave the gallbladder alone and take the stone from a proximal site to the impaction, not from the same site of impaction. Remember, from the most common benign liver lesion is the hemangioma. It's the most common benign tumor of the mesenchymal origin. Incidence in autopsy about 8%. The cavernous hemangioma may be enormous, and the lesions are normally separated from the normal liver by a ring of fibrosis tissue. In ultrasound, it's typically hyperechoic. So take care, a large hyperechoic lesion in presence of normal alpha fetoprotein, it's hemangioma. In hepatocellular carcinoma of equivalent size will almost always result in raising of the alpha fetoprotein. So alpha fetoprotein is your cutoff between hemangioma and hepatocellular carcinoma. Take care, in both benign and malignant biliary obstruction, it may be treated by placement of stent. This may be either plastic tube or self-expanding metallic stent. They can be placed either percutaneously or at ERCP, or less commonly now, open surgery. Complication might include blockage or displacement, and those related to the method of the insertion. ERCP itself may cause acute pancreatitis. Take care regarding hepatocellular adenoma. 90% of the women will have hepatocellular adenoma in their fifth or third decade of life. From the 30 to 50 year old, 90% of the women will have hepatocellular adenoma because it's linked to the use of the oral contraceptive pills, and lesions are usually solitary. They are usually sharply demarcated from the normal liver, although they usually lack fibrous capsule. Remember the hemangioma was having a fibrous capsule, while the hepatocellular adenoma of the liver will have no fibrous capsule, and on ultrasound it will be mixed echogenicity and heterogeneous, and hypodense in CCT. So hepatocellular adenoma, hypodense, and mixed echogenicity and heterogeneous, unlike the hemangioma. There is no confusion and conflict between the adenoma and the hemangioma. The patient with hemorrhage or symptom removal of the adenoma may be required. Asymptomatic adenoma more than 5 cm are usually excised, and adenoma in male are likely to be smaller but have a high greater risk of malignant transformation. Just like the breast cancer, a male is more dangerous than female, as swelling in the breast of the male, no matter how fluffy or how breast mouse-like, it will be more malignant than female, because it's unlikely. So, hepatocellular adenoma, in 90% of the females will acquire hepatocellular adenoma in their middle 30 to 50 year old, but a male, it's a serious complication and greater risk for malignant transformation. As a rule, in obstructive jaundice, whatever the cause, you can always depend on ERCP for stenting. If failed ERCP, go for BTC. BTC is a short for percutaneous transhepatic cholangiogram. Remember, in the presence of metastatic disease in pancreatic tumor, this will make it incurable cancer, and the resection of metastasis disease is inoperable and not appropriate. So we are looking for, yes, palliation. So, metastatic pancreatic cancer, we are looking for palliation, and this is done by insertion of endoscopic biliary stent and consideration of palliative chemotherapy. Whenever you are suspecting a bile duct injury and a bile leak, in most of the cases, ERCP is the most appropriate investigation because it's diagnostic and therapeutic. Again, in gallstone ileus, leave the gallbladder alone and remove the stone at a proximal site from the site of impaction, not at the same site of obstruction, but at a proximal site of the impaction, and leave the gallbladder alone. So, amylase and lipase are both used for diagnosis of acute pancreatitis, but amylase may give false negative and false positive because it's not specific and shorter half-life. The lipase is more specific with longer half-life, and remember, the trypsin is what is caused autodigestion of the pancreas, not the lipase, not the amylase, and many reasons can cause hyperamylasemia, even acute cholecystitis or myocarditis or myocardial infarction or infarction of the intestine. All of these inflammatory processes can cause acute raise in the amylase level, but the lipase level is very specific and sensitive for acute pancreatitis. Rheum is defined as common hepatic duct obstruction caused by extrinsic compression from an impacted stone in the cystic duct or the infundibulum of the gallbladder. And patients with Merezi syndrome can present with jaundice, fever, and right hepatic upper quadrant pain. Take care, Merezi syndrome at Hartmann Pausch, impacted stone at Hartmann. It might cause and lead to the fistula between the cystoduodenal fistula, and eventually the stone may pass through the duodenum causing gallstone ileus. Merezi syndrome is a very serious complication of gallstone. Whenever a pancreatic necrosis is suspected, please don't proceed with any management before taking a guided fine needle aspirate for culture. After this, you can go for management, but there is no necrosectomy before proving that this is a pancreatic necrosis by fine needle. A calculus cholecystitis is a very challenging diagnosis and must be in mind and very missed because the patient mostly will be hospitalized and it will be in a patient with intercurrent illness like diabetes or organ failure. He is admitted in the hospital and missed. So long-term illness will cause a calculus cholecystitis and must be in mind. And the management of this patient, if the patient is fit for cholecystectomy, we will go for cholecystectomy. If unfit, then percutaneous cholecystostomy of this calculus cholecystitis. A calculus cholecystitis means there is no stone in this gallbladder. However, it's inflamed. The patient will be systemically unwell, and the gallbladder inflammation in the absence of a stone with high fever. Again, the patient, if fit for cholecystectomy, go for it. If unfit, go for percutaneous cholecystostomy. Otherwise, it will cause empyema.
Sarcomas are malignant tumor of mesenchymal origin. 40% of sarcoma are found in extremities. Cell carcinoma of the esophagus. It's commonly treated with chemo radiotherapy. And so, fibrosis and dysphagia may occur in survivors. At 6 years post-treatment, recurrence would be most unusual. So most likely will be radiation stricture when the patient will complain of long history of dysphagia, but not progressive. Walnut tumor, which is a nephroblastoma, is the most common malignant kidney tumor in children, rarely seen in adults. Again, walnut tumor, which is a nephroblastoma, which is a renal tumor that arises from the embryonic tissue, generally affects children with 75% being under the age of 5. Most common type of childhood kidney cancer, and it's the fourth most common type of childhood cancer across the world. Tumor are usually present unilateral but can be bilateral. Tumors are frequently able to grow without detection. The tumor is large at discovery, but could before metastasis can occur. Average weight of the tumor at diagnosis is 1 pound, but the tumor can grow up to 10 pounds. The 5-year survival rate 90%, which is highest across all childhood cancers. Remember that Paget disease of the nipple associated with invasive ductal carcinoma. Liver cell adenomas are linked to oral contraceptive pills, and 90% of the patients with liver cell adenoma have used the oral contraceptive pills. Liver function tests are often normal. The lesions will typically have a mixed acuity and heterogeneous texture. Remember that hemangioma will be hyperechoic, but the mixed echogenicity will be for adenoma. Amoebic liver abscess is the most common extra-intestinal manifestation of amoebiasis in humans. Between 75% to 90% of the lesion will occur in the right lobe of the liver. Presenting complaints typically include fever and right upper quadrant pain. Ultrasonography would usually show a fluid-filled structure with poorly defined boundaries. And it's important that we have a poorly defined boundaries because in echinococcal granulosis, you will have a defined boundaries of the daughter cyst. Again, the amoebic abscess, aspiration via a minimally invasive radio-assisted pigtail, for example, will be the rule. There is no surgery in amoebic abscess, but aspiration with local invasive intervention radiology, as well as treatment with metronidazole systemic. Malignant hypertension is extremely high blood pressure that develops rapid and causes some type of organ damage. In malignant hypertension, the accelerated hypertension underlying change will cause hypertensive nephrosclerosis with superimposed fibrinoid necrosis of the vessel wall. In this vessel, fibrin within the vessel wall has sequence of necrosis as well. Diaphragm disease is seen when the lumen of the small intestine is divided into short compartments by circular membranes of mucosa and submucosa. These membranes have a pinhole lumen, leading to frequent bouts of intestinal obstruction. The condition is said to be rare and associated with prolonged use of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. Someone, when he feels a little pain, takes non-steroidal anti-inflammatory. He will get peptic ulcer and diaphragmatic disease. It's more common in the elderly group because they are more likely to take non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug in the long term, especially for the bone disease. It's usually treated by surgical resection, unfortunately, and the condition typically results in small bowel obstruction. Anaplastic thyroid carcinoma is most commonly found in elderly females, but unfortunately it has a very high incidence for local invasion, and this accounts for 10% of all thyroid cancers. Thank God, because the treatment is by resection whenever possible, and palliation may be achieved through ethmoidectomy or radiotherapy, because chemotherapy is ineffective at all. Roughly, we can say it has a very poor prognosis, just like the medullary carcinoma. That's why pray for your patient to be a papillary carcinoma, not a follicular, not anaplastic, not medullary. Papillary carcinoma have a lymph node metastasis, unlike the follicular carcinoma, which have a blood metastasis. That's why God blessed us with the papillary carcinoma, which is 60% of all thyroid cancers, which is less invasive and less malignant than the others, the best of the malignant. And the anaplastic have tendency to have a local invasion, while the medullary carcinoma have a familial genetic disease and have both lymphatic and hematogenous metastasis. That's why it's a very poor prognosis. Medullary carcinoma and pheochromocytoma both in men too, type 2A and type 2B. They aren't in men type 1. In men type 1, with letter P, pituitary adenoma, parathyroid hyperplasia, and pancreatic tumor. Again, men type 1 have pituitary adenoma, parathyroid hyperplasia, and pancreatic tumors. Men syndrome, multiple endocrine neoplasia type 2, P, is characterized by mucosal neuroma and morphonoid body habitus beside the medullary thyroid carcinoma and the pheochromocytoma. While the medullary carcinoma and pheochromocytoma with the parathyroid hyperplasia found in men 2A. Remember that desmoid tumor is associated with the cell type of myofibroblast. Desmoid tumor are fibrous neoplasm arising from musculoapneuritic structure and typically contain proliferation of the myofibroblast. They are usually firm over crust of the tissue with propensity to local infiltration, and it's very famous to be a part of the Gardner syndrome. Gardner syndrome has a triad: bronchiectasis, sinusitis, and situs inversus, where a mirror image arranged organ, that the heart and the stomach are on the right instead of being in the left normally. And remember, Gardner syndrome is autosomal recessive trait due to defect in ciliary motility, and affected male have infertility due to sperm tail immobility. So, when you see a patient coming to you with sinusitis and you do chest x-ray, find it situs inversus, the poor patient might be infertile as well. Thanks for the humanity, because he won't bring up more infertile Gardner syndrome patient, because it's recessive gene. He must marry a Gardner syndrome to get us a fully Gardner patient. Remember that Lynch syndrome is autosomal dominant and develop colonic cancer and endometrial cancer at young age. 80% of the affected individual will get colonic and endometrial cancer as well. The high-risk individual may be identified using Amsterdam criteria. Remember Gardner syndrome. It's autosomal dominant familial colorectal polyposis, so it might be associated with familial adenomatous polypi, familial adenoma polypi, which is 100% precancerous, with multiple colonic polyposis as well in Gardner syndrome. Extra colonic disease include skull osteoma, thyroid cancer, and epidermoid cyst. So whenever you face a patient with osteoma or thyroid cancer or desmoid tumor or epidermoid cyst, please keep Gardner syndrome in your mind. Think of this patient might have familial polyposis coli. He might be having a precancerous 100% disease like the familial polyposis coli. The mutation of ABC gene located on chromosome 5, and due to colonic polyposis, most of the patients undergo colectomy to reduce the risk of colorectal cancer, because it's 100% precancerous. And now it's considered as a variant of the familial adenomatous polypi coli, the Gardner syndrome. Remember that Leigh-Friedmani syndrome is autosomal dominant, consists of germline mutation to P53 tumor suppressor gene, and its tumor marker is the P53 tumor gene, and the high incidence of malignancy, particularly sarcoma and leukemia. A very common recall about Leigh-Friedmani syndrome associated with sarcoma and leukemia. By the way, Leigh-Friedmani syndrome have to be in your mind when you get an individual which developed sarcoma under the age of 45 years. Like for example, a first degree relative diagnosed with any cancer below the 45 year old, and another family member developed a malignancy under 45 year, or sarcoma at any age. Think of Leigh-Friedmani syndrome in your mind, by the way. Remember that BRCA1 is carried on chromosome 17 and BRCA2 on chromosome 13. BRCA1 17, BRCA2 13. 1 17, 2 13. 17 before 13 in breast. They are linked to developing breast cancer in 60% risk. And by the way, BRCA1 and BRCA2 raise the awareness about breast cancer because Angelina Jolie, the Hollywood actress, have them.
and they are associated with developing ovarian cancer in 55% with BRCA1 and 25% in BRCA2. Dearest friend, never forget Gardner syndrome again with the familial Pulposis coli and the extra-intestinal manifestation like the supernumerary teeth, multiple teeth extra other than the normal teeth number, and jaw osteomas, congenital hypertrophy of the retinal pigmentation, osteoma of the skull, thyroid cancer, epidermoid cyst, fibroma, and sebaceous cyst, and desmoid tumor. All of this will raise awareness for Gardner syndrome. Must be alert in your mind. So as Dr. Naveen said, better to lose your teeth in the garden better than getting extra teeth in Gardner syndrome. Garden is happy with the family. Gardner is tumor in the colon. Remember that hypospadias, the urethral meat is open on the ventral surface of the penis, and there is also a ventral deficiency of the foreskin. The urethral meatus may open more proximally in more severe variants. However, 75% of the opening are distally located, thank God. The more distant, the more easier to reconstruct. The incidence is about 1 to 300 male per, so hypospadias is common. It's not uncommon. 1 to 300 male per is very common, by the way. The features are absence of renal artery, ventrally open gland, skin tethering to hypoplastic urethra, splayed colon or spongiosum tissue distal to the meatus, and deficiency of the foreskin ventrally, as we have said before. And the management is no circumcision of the cultural bleed right now, please. The skin, the redundant extra skin of the foreskin will be used to reconstruct the urethra and modify the urethra to the normal positioning to improve the fertility of this patient. And psychologically, with his friend, child, observe each other. So, management will be urethroplasty and no circumcision and benign reconstruction. The foreskin is often utilized to reconstruct this process. In boys with very distal disease, no treatment may be needed if it's slight angulation. And remember that cryptorchidism is about 10% of the cases of hypospadias may occur and might be associated with urological abnormalities in up to 40% of the infant. So when you find the hypospadias, search for any other anomalies and exclude them, especially the urological abnormalities. Subclavian steel syndrome. It's associated with stenosis or occlusion of the subclavian artery proximal to the origin of the vertebral artery. As a result, the increased metabolic need of the arm, this causes retrograde flow and symptoms of CNS vascular insufficiency. This is the subclavian steel syndrome. By the way, the Takayasu arthritis is a large vessel granulomatous vasculitis. It results in intima narrowing and most commonly affect young Asian females. Patient present with feature of mild systemic illness followed by pulseless phase, this is your key to think of the vascular insufficiency of Takayasu arthritis, and a very common recall in the exam, by the way. The only key in the case will be pulseless phase after mild systemic illness in an Asian female. The treatment is with systemic steroids. Takayasu arthritis, pulseless phase after systemic illness in an Asian female. Achondroplasia. Achondroplasia is a common cause of dwarfism and is caused by defect in the fibroblast growth factor receptor. In most cases, about 70% of the cases, occurs as a sporadic mutation. Important to know, it's more common to be a sporadic mutation, a very common recall, by the way. The main risk factor is advancing parental age at the time of conception. The parent delayed their conceiving, or they are very old. Once present, it's typically inherited in an autosomal dominant fashion, unfortunately. So, it's autosomal dominant, sporadic mutation. The radiological features are large skull with narrow foramen magnum, short flattened vertebral bodies, narrow spinal canal, horizontal acetabular roof, and broad short metacarpals. And again, it's a common cause for dwarfism. There is no specific treatment, unfortunately. However, some individuals may benefit from limb lengthening procedure via Elizarov. If you don't know, the Elizarov is a modern technique to use in lengthening procedures and in extra bone fixations, by the way. A clearly defined need and endpoint is the cornerstone of achieving success with such a procedure. In simple words, achondroplasia, common cause for dwarfism, autosomal dominant, sporadic mutation, and there is no specific treatment. Elizarov frame may be used for bone lengthening. Read the question well. He is stating he have done Hartmann procedure to treat the fistula. And if there is a fistula, we never use a suction drain. Even if there is a fistula, doing a suction drain will keep the fistula ongoing. But the bag non-suction drain will make the fistula close by time. That's what we are putting drain for, to know is it high output fistula or low output fistula. Suctioning will keep the fistula ongoing as a high output fistula. So take care. Again, the question is stating that the operation was done to treat the fistula. The Hartmann procedure was done to treat the fistula. Suction drains are mainly inserted to close the dead space. Because if there is a dead space, there is a liability for precipitation of fluid and contamination of this precipitated fluid and fluid collection. That's why we tend to use suction drain in some operation, like thyroidectomy. What would you use? Suction drain or non-suction drain? Put a suction drain after your manipulation to close this dead space. After abdominoplasty, we use suction drain. After exploration, we only use intraperitoneal, we use a back drain. The suction drain intraperitoneal, by the way, will be closed by the omentum. The omentum will creep over this suction drain and close all its pores. That's why we use non-suction back drain. Take care. Cholecystostomy is a procedure where we put a drain inside the gallbladder when it's difficult to do cholecystectomy. Cholecystectomy is removal of the gallbladder. Don't confuse both. Remember, carcinoma of the prostate typically occur in the posterior loop, while the median loop is usually enlarged in the PBH. The anterior loop has a little in the way of the glandular tissue and seldom being enlarged. Again, posterior cancerous, median, PBH. To diagnose nasopharyngeal diagnosis, we have a Trotter triad: unilateral conductive hearing loss, ipsilateral facial and ear pain, and ipsilateral paralysis of soft palate. Ipsilateral means on the same side. Take care, villous adenoma carries the highest risk of malignant transformation. To do segmental resection or complete colectomy should be considered with colonic polyp. If there is incomplete excision of malignant polyp, or a malignant sessile polyp we have, or a malignant bedunculated polyp with submucosal invasion, as well as polyp with poorly differentiated carcinoma, and of course our 100% carcinoma, the familial polyposis coli. Take care. Budd-Jagger syndrome is an autosomal dominant condition characterized by numerous benign hamartomatous polyps in the gastrointestinal tract, and also associated with pigmented freckles on the lips, face, palm, and soles. And by the way, those pigmentation are the key in your exam. The pigmentation in the freckles of the lip and face and palm of the soles. Around 50% of the patient will have died from gastrointestinal tract cancer by at least age of 60. As if age of 60 is still young. May God give him long life. Genetically, it's autosomal dominant again, and the responsible gene includes serine threonine kinase.
the LKB1 and STK11. The features: hamartomatous polyps, pigmented lesion on the lips and oral mucosa, face and palm and shoulder again. Intestinal obstruction might happen, as well as intussusception, which may lead to diagnosis if missed from the pigmentation. I don't know which doctor can miss the diagnosis of this pigmentation and don't feel suspicious. And the gastrointestinal bleeding, the management will be conservative unless complication develop. So don't marry Abu-Jagger syndrome unless you are playing the Beauty and the Beast. Remember the types of hypersensitivity. Hypersensitivity reactions are acid, for short, anaphylaxis, cytotoxic, immune complex, and delayed hypersensitivity. Those are acid. Type 1 will be anaphylactic. Type 2 will be cytotoxic. Type 3 will be immune complex. Type 4 will be delayed hypersensitivity. And in case you forgot, remember, hypersensitivity reactions are acid. Again, type 1 anaphylactic, type 2 cytotoxic, type 3 immune complex, type 4 delayed hypersensitivity. Take care. With liposuction for plastic surgeons or bone fractures with orthopedics, think of fat embolism. There is a triad to keep it in mind: respiratory symptoms, neurological symptoms, and petechial rash or TK rash, because the P is silent. It tends to occur after the first two symptoms, after respiratory and neurological. So if in case you have missed the respiratory symptoms deterioration and neurological manifestation deterioration, and the petechial appeared rash on her chest or in the chest of the patient, what else can be done to make you think of fat embolism? Keep it in mind, it's fatal problem. Mucinous carcinoma comprise about 2-3% of all breast cancer. However, your key in the exam will be the gray gelatinous surface and the smooth surface macroscopically. You have to keep it in mind with each feature. Take care. Carcinoembryonic antigen, the CEA, is elevated in colonic cancer. However, the screening for colonic cancer using CEA is not yet justified, because it can be falsely elevated in number of non-malignant diseases and it's not specific, such as cirrhosis and colitis, and for this reason it has no role in monitoring in colonic cancer. Remember, in colorectal cancer, colonoscopy is a gold standard, provided it's complete and good mucosal visualization is achieved. Other options include double contrast barium enema and CT colonography. Remember, regarding carcinoid syndrome, carcinoid tumors secrete serotonin and originate in the neuroendocrine Abbott cells, mainly in the intestine, the midgut, distal ileum, appendix. But take care, they can occur also in the rectum and bronchi. Hormonal symptoms mainly occur when the disease spread outside the bowel, and the clinical features will be of insidious onset over many years, and the flushing of the face, palpitation, pulmonary valve stenosis, asthma, and the fear, diarrhea. All of this will raise the suspicion for the carcinoid syndrome, not the carcinoid tumor itself, but the carcinoid syndrome, which are flushing of the face, palpitation, pulmonary valve, asthma, severe diarrhea. And to investigate the carcinoid syndrome, you have to investigate for the 5-HIAA in 24-hour urine collection, somatostatin receptor scintigraphy, and CT scan, as well as blood testing for chromographin A. Treatment will be octreotide and surgical removal. Again, remember, the testicular tumors are mainly teratoma and seminoma. Teratoma from T, toddler, seminoma from S, senile. The cut edge will be 30. Before 30, teratoma. After 30, will be seminoma. This is a fast mnemonic to remember in the exam. Remember, individuals with long-standing Crohn's disease are at high risk of gallstone,
collection. Because of impairment of the enterohepatic recycling of bile salt, and formation of enteroenteric fistulation may produce malabsorption. Thicker amyloidosis may complicate chronic inflammatory state. Remember, Filty syndrome have a very famous triad of rheumatoid disease, splenomegaly, and neutropenia. When you find a rheumatoid patient with splenomegaly and neutropenia, think for Filty syndrome. Remember, Crohn's disease is a mouse to anus disease with cobblestone appearance macroscopically and abscess ulceration. The depth of the disease, transmural inflammation, takes the whole thickness transmurally, unlike the ulcerative colitis, which is superficial inflammation. The distribution of Crohn's is patchy, and histologically you will find it granulomatous, but take care, it's non-caseating epithelioid. Again, Crohn's disease from mouth to anus, cobblestone appearance, abscess ulceration, transmural inflammation, patchy distribution, granuloma, no caseation. The extra-intestinal manifestation of Crohn's are very important in the records. It causes abscess ulcer, erythema nodosum, take care, erythema nodosum with Crohn's, and bioderma gangrenosum with Crohn's, and acute arthropathy and ocular manifestation. Again, there is no erythema marginatum, but erythema nodosum. Take care, Crohn's causes bioderma gangrenosum. And other unrelated to the disease, extra-intestinal manifestation like sacroiliitis, ankylosing spondylitis, primary sclerosing cholangitis, gallstones, and renal calculi. Okay, take care exactly from that the Crohn is able to create gallstones and erythema nodosum and bioderma gangrenosum. Those three records in your exam. Duodenal polyp occur in up to 100% of the patient with familial adenomatous blopi, just as the familial adenomatous blopi are 100% cancerous. You know that although duodenal polyp occur in up to 100% of the patient of the familial adenomatous blopi, the duodenal polyp are the commonest extracolonic lesion of familial adenomatous blopi. Yes, they are extracolonic. Duodenum is ileum, according with the small intestine, not the colon, so it's considered as extracolonic manifestation. And take care, gastric fundal polyp are seen in about 50% of the patient, and the skull stoma are seen in Gardner syndrome again. Angiomyolipoma. Angio means vessels, myo means muscular, lipoma means fat. Angiomyolipoma, it's a tumor composed of blood vessel and smooth muscle and fat. 80% of the hamartomas occur sporadically. The remainder are associated with tuberous sclerosis. 50% with a lesion more than 4 cm will have symptom and will require surgical resection. Massive bleeding may occur in up to 10% of the cases. Regarding pheochromocytoma, remember it's a neuroendocrine tumor of chromaffin cell of adrenal medulla. Again, of adrenal medulla, neuroendocrine tumor, this is a pheochromocytoma. Very famous with hypertension and hyperglycemia. Whenever you face a patient with hypertension and hyperglycemia, please think of pheochromocytoma. And remember, it's 10% rule. 10% of the cases are bilateral, so thank God this means that 90% of the cases will be unilateral. So 10% of bilateral, 10% occur in children, so mostly in adult. 11% are malignant, so it's mostly benign. 10% will be hypertensive, so 90% will be hypertensive. Again, rule of 10. 10% bilateral, 10% children, 10% malignant, 10% will not be hypertensive. For me, I think it must be a rule of 90, not 10. Hypertrophic scarring and keloid scarring are complication or faulty healing. Scar is the end of any wound, but keloid extend beyond the limit of the incision, but the hypertrophic scar never extend beyond the limit of the incision. Both are challenging to be treated, by the way. Keloid is more challenging. Both use steroid injection and compression, silicone sheeting and silicone gel massaging. For resistant cases of keloid and large space of keloid, radiation might be used, especially post-burn keloids, as well as compression garments. The anal lymph node range above the dentate line will be to the mesorectal lymph node. Below the dentate line will be to the superficial inguinal node. The cutoff is the dentate line. Very famous circle is a post-splenectomy blood film feature. Post-splenectomy blood film features will compromise Howell Jolie body and Pappenheimer bodies and target cell, as well as irregular contracted erythrocyte. Again, Howell Jolie bodies and Pappenheimer bodies and target cell, as well as irregular contracted erythrocyte. Those are post-splenectomy blood film features. So, the changes after splenectomy in the blood film. In the first few days after splenectomy, target cells, siderocytes, and reticulocytes will appear in the circulation. Immediately following splenectomy, a granulocytosis, mainly composed of neutrophils, is seen. This is replaced by lymphocytosis and monocytosis over the following weeks. The platelets count usually increased, and this may be persistent. An oral antiplatelet agent may be needed in some patients. And remember, in post-splenectomy, you have to be aware of the overwhelming post-splenectomy sepsis, and as well as he must take his vaccination. Hodgkin lymphoma has a better prognosis than non-Hodgkin lymphoma. And in case if you forgot, remember that each one of you will put his name after a very nice prognosis case. So Dr. Hodgkin put his name over the Hodgkin lymphoma with the better prognosis. And the other type of the lymphoma, he said, this is not Hodgkin's lymphoma. This with a bad prognosis, and put his name on the better prognosis lymphoma, just in case if you forgot. Sternberg cell is very characteristic for Hodgkin lymphoma, by the way. Let's agree that myofibroblast is the main cell found in the remodeling phase during wound healing. Let's agree again on the Howell-Jolie bodies and the Hines bodies, as well as Pappenheimer bodies and target cell with irregular contracted erythrocytes are found post-splenectomy blood film. Of course, post-splenectomy, never forget to give the patient his vaccines needed, the pneumococcus and H influenza and meningococcal vaccine. Best friend, remember, Leaf-Remaney syndrome is autosomal dominant case. Consists of germline mutation to P53 tumor suppressor gene. Have high incidence of malignancies, particularly sarcoma and leukemia. This is a very common recall in the exam, asking you about the malignancies associated with Leaf-Remaney syndrome, the sarcoma and leukemia. Sarcoma most probably would be developed below the age of 45, and a first degree relative diagnosed with any cancer below 45 year, and another family member develop malignancy under 45 year sarcoma at any age, please think for Leaf-Remaney syndrome. Regarding the genes of BRCA1 and BRCA2, they are associated with developing ovarian cancer. I know they are related to breast cancer, but 55% with BRCA1 will have a malignancy in the ovary, and 25% with BRCA2 will have malignancy in the ovary. So keep them in mind. BRCA1 17, BRCA2 13. BRCA1 carried on chromosome 17, and BRCA2 is carried on chromosome 13. Dear friends, Takayasu arthritis most commonly affect young Asian female, and this is will be your key in the exam. Takayasu with Asian female. The case will be talking about pulseless peripheries. This is the classical finding in Takayasu arthritis, by the way.
The CNS symptoms may be variable, so depend on Asian female, pulsatile peripheral. This is the classic finding in your exam. Paget disease of the nipple, Paget disease of the breast. Paget disease is an eczematous change of the nipple associated with an underlying breast malignancy. It's present in 1-2% of the patient with breast cancer. In half of this patient, it's associated with underlying mass lesion, and 90% of such patients will have invasive carcinoma, by the way. 30% of the patient without a mass lesion will still be found to have underlying carcinoma. So, take care of Paget disease. When you find a weeping crusty lesion, such lesion around the nipple must rise in your mind, it might be Paget disease. It's not just a crustacean. No normal female have crustacean around their nipple. The remainder will have carcinoma inside. So Paget disease differ from eczema of the nipple in that it involves the nipple primarily and only later on spread to the areola. So Paget disease is spread first in the nipple, then to the areola. The opposite will occur in eczema. The eczema will start in areola, then the nipple. The diagnosis is made by punch biopsy. This is a common record. Punch biopsy in Paget disease is a common record. Mammography and ultrasonography of the breast, of course, is the completion of the triple survey, triple assessment of any breast. Treatment will depend on the underlying lesion. So take care from Paget, start in the nipple, then to the areola. Most will have mass. If not mass, it will be in situ. The crustacean around the nipple is your key, and punch biopsy is the way we have biopsy from Paget disease. Dearest friends, osteoclastoma has a characteristic appearance on X-ray with multiple lytic and lucent area. Subpapil appearance. So subpapil appearance is lytic and lucent area. This is characteristic for osteoclastoma. Pathological feature may occur, and the disease is usually indolent. Take care. Regarding hamartoma, hamartoma is a benign neoplasm that is compromised of tissue structure that normally found within the organ they appear. So, if they appear in the lung, they will have connective tissue, mature cartilage, and ciliated epithelium. The normal tissues that appear in the lung. So the lung is one of the common sites of hamartoma formation, and they comprise about 5% of all lung lesions. They generally have a good prognosis, by the way, thank God. Don't require excision unless symptomatic. So hamartoma is benign neoplasm comprised of tissue structure that normally found within the organ they appear in. No need to excision except they are symptomatic. Dearest friend, in established aneurysmal disease, there is a dilatation of all layer of the arterial wall and loss of both elastin and collagen. The primary event is loss of elastic fiber with subsequent degradation of collagen fiber. Dearest friend, abdominal aortic aneurysm occur primarily as a result of failure of elastic protein within extracellular matrix, as we have agreed on. And aneurysm typically represent dilatation of all layer of the arterial wall. If only one layer dilated, this is pseudoaneurysm. So all layers of the arterial wall, if dilated, this is a true aneurysm. Most of aneurysm are caused by degenerative disease. After the age of 50 years, notice that the normal diameter of an infrarenal aorta is 1.5 centimeter. Or 1.7 centimeter, 1.5 in female, 1.7 in male. So any diameter beyond this limit, beyond 3 centimeter and greater, is considered aneurysm until proven otherwise. The pathophysiology involved in the development of aneurysm is complex, and the primary event is loss of intima with loss of elastic fiber from the media. This process is associated with potentiated by increased proteolytic activity and lymphocytic infiltration. Major risk factor is development of aneurysm include smoking and hypertension.
Rare but important other causes include syphilis and connective tissue disease like Ehlers-Danlos type 1 and Marfan syndrome. Dearest friend, remember, amoebic abscess. Liver amoebic abscess is the most common extra-intestinal manifestation of amoebiasis. About 90% of the lesion in the right lobe presenting with complaint like include fever in right upper quadrant and pain. Ultrasonography will be definitive for this diagnosis. It will show poorly defined boundaries collection and aspiration yield sterile odorless fluid which has an anchovy paste consistency, and treatment will be metronidazole. Dear friend, it's rare to have a cancer manifesting with fever, so don't put it in first differential when you are having a fever. Rare, very rare. It's malignant, it's sneaky, it's mean. No mean one will appear with any symptom. The mass will be hidden until incidental discovery. That's why it's cancer. It's not easily diagnosed, but it has to be in our differential. Dear great surgeon, take care. Pancreatitis is studied in surgery, even it's for conservative treatment, because most of pancreatitis pass without any complication and rarely goes to pancreatic necrosis. So we are studying pancreatitis to know that this acute abdomen, if diagnosed as pancreatitis, there is no need for laparotomy or even a surgical intervention. Is for conservative supportive treatment only. This is pancreatitis. But whenever pancreatitis complicates with pancreatic necrosis, you have first to confirm that this is a pancreatic necrosis. How to confirm it? With fine needle. After confirmation with fine needle, then you can go with pancreatic necrosectomy for pancreatic necrosis. This is the only indication for pancreatic necrosis intervention. You are sure with evidence that this is a pancreatic necrosis. But pancreatitis, it almost always will heal with conservative supportive treatment. And if the cause was due to gallstone or alcohol or whatever the cause, you have to treat the cause later on after managing the acute pancreatitis state. Hope this answer your query and make it clear. God be with you.